Whole Story Quest Audiobooks presents Sweet Fruit, Sour Land by Rebecca Ley, narrated by Jessamine-Bliss. Prologue. I found a lemon yesterday. It was wrinkled and old and down the back of the food cupboard at work. They had some bounce left in it yet. I wanted to show it to you, even now. I stood in the kitchen in our 15-minute break and broke the skin. I laid it out, unwinding it, squeezing what was left of its flesh, and tore it out of itself. I splayed it and scraped its insides out and smelt them, citrus gone bad. I washed the skin and pricked it with my fingernails, trying to see, or smell, or taste, if there was anything left in the zest. I rinsed it under the tap and kept the base intact, where the skin meets at its core. Do you remember how they work? And left it out to dry. I got a needle and thread from my workstation. The thread was black, but it worked all the same. I sewed it back up together from each bit that I peeled and tore, and it looked quite good like that. It looked like a whole piece of fruit again. But Mathilde came in and laughed at me. She did that to keep the shock of seeing a lemon off her face. I could tell. Fruit art? She said. I didn't think it was art. I thought what would have been art would be the way that you'd have looked at it, if you could see how I'd preserved it. That would be the art, the look on your face, if only you could see it. On the bad days, I think about calling you. Our landlady has a phone, if you can believe it. It stays on all day, as it needs so little electricity. Did you ever know that? Sometimes when the evenings are quiet, I go to her house. I tell her I might make a call, but I only pick it up and listen to the dial tone. I like the tinny electric noise. I hold it fast against my ear and hear the sound even after I've replaced the receiver. I think of dialing in your number. I'm trying to forget the numbers, you see, one by one. I think I've forgotten half of them, but I'm not sure which ones. Sometimes I look at all this rain coming down and wonder if you ever have a day where you look at the rain, too. I think about the Thames Barrier and London's little peaks and troughs, and I feel very far away. There's little sun here, so the solar power is mostly useless. Not like in London, where it powered what it could. If the sun has a kind of sentience, I'd like to apologize to it. If it can remember the beginning of the earth, maybe it can remember the beginning of man and all that's come with us. I'd like to apologize for what we've done. Or maybe our apology is our suffering for it now. I think about the beginning because it's better than now. I think about the avocados we used to have, plenty of them, the vanilla ice cream we added to them, the sugar, the milk, my grandmother blending the mixture and handing it to us in ceramic bowls, the way she held the avocado in her hand and peeled its skin, the way it squished into the blender as we waited expectantly by the counter. I dream of Mama Boga and her basket of avocados. I dream of the Nairobi sun and the dry, kind heat. I imagine taking that avocado from Mama and holding it in my hand. A thing I couldn't dream of touching now, its scaly flesh, its weight, like a small breast of agriculture, a plump divinity. How strange the things you end up worshipping that you would never guess. Part 1. Mathilde. Tender. After we came to London, I dreamt of my mother again. She appeared to me fully formed, her dark hair in Velcro rollers, and her mouth pulled together in a small smile. I reached out to touch her, wanting to feel the blank surface of her skin, and the folds of her eyelids, and the weight of her shoulders. Then, like all dreamers, I was possessed with supernatural skills and became her. I opened my mouth and her voice came out, and I looked down and saw her perfectly oval nails on my hands. I turned to the window with our old green shutters, looking out on Rue des Rosiers, and knew, the way you know in a dream, that I was her. I was a young woman standing above our little cobbled street. I opened the windows, pushing hard against the wood into the glass panes flung before me, and I could smell the myrtille baking in their tarts from the café downstairs. I walked to our small kitchen, 7 floors up from the street, 1 step from the space of the living room and 2 from the window, and put the kettle on the hob. I tore up mint leaves with the same dexterity she did. I brought down 2 blue mugs painted by hand, with small yellow flowers around the rim. The kettle started to gurgle, and I looked again at my hands, my mother's hands, and in that same alarming state of self-awareness, I knew I had aged considerably. The folds around my knuckles were pronounced, and there were brown spots up my arms. I moved them up and down, like a bird, and felt the fullness of them move with me. I had grown old and was afraid, and the kettle hadn't boiled yet. I rubbed my hands on a tea towel, which was spattered with old crepe batter, but crepes were nowhere to be found, and I sat on my bed, which now appeared in the living room. Just as I sat down, I found I couldn't lift myself from it. I made several attempts, trying desperately, but they only made me weaker until I had to lie back and look at the ceiling. It was cracked and speckled with mold, and I remembered how for years we'd been meaning to repaint it. I lay on my back and the window was still open, and the tart was still baking, and the kettle was still boiling. But I could only watch it and sense that it was going on without me. Possessed with that old dreamer's skill, I lifted off and out through the window. Either in body or consciousness, it was hard to tell. And now, the Paris of Marais cafes and trinket théières was left behind. In my aviation, I saw Paris for what it became, later, after my mother died, and we left. I saw the president's family hiding in the attic of l'Alimentarie on the Rue des Écouffes. I saw the rebels, round every corner, with their guns, the towering machine-like things the gendarmes once had. And then, in a dreamlike whimsy, I drifted above the whole country and saw the land for what was left of it, scorched and tropical, parched and cracked, diseased. I don't know if I, as my mother, was surprised or upset. In this floating, omniscient state, my only feeling was being very far away from it all, and only wanting to retire back to the kitchen, put the mint plant back on the windowsill, close the shutters, and drink the tea. The French community in London would all say the same. They all had dreams of the homes they once had, and they would suggest these dreams were a sign of guilt, that we got out and others didn't. I say this, but I can't be sure. After I left with my grandmother, we moved as far away from French people as we could. I tried to forget my own language and small French affectations. They took practice to shake. I should have changed my name, but I couldn't rid myself of it, because in my dreams, as my mother, I knew I was looking for small infant me. In them, I said my own name, just as she once said it. And you just can't forget a thing like that. Years afterwards, Mathilde was still my name, and as an adult, I still dreamt of my mother. Years later, after we'd come to London and fled Paris. Years after we'd pulled the ladder up after us. 2. Clothes were strung on the branches of the heath trees. If I think of anything now, it is the smell of London soap and the sound of slapping cotton in the wind. I would wander to the farm's edges and stare in the windows of the cottages that met me there. I saw a man with a hat tucked neatly over his forehead, asleep against a trunk, leg jutted out in front of him. He was meant to be keeping an eye on his carrots and potatoes at the back of his cottage. I walked along the public meadow and watched them too. Sometimes they gave you leftovers if you looked at them a certain way. If you looked hungry and scared, but not too afraid. Civilized with tidy hair, but with dirt underneath your fingernails, and a smudge against your face. They were the ones with the food, so they were the ones with the power. I worked in the sewing shop with my grandmother, which was clean work and difficult in a different sort of way. So before I made it to the cottages, I would scrape my hands under the mud on its borders and brush my hair with it, raking it with my fingers. We'd usually do as well as anyone else with the rations, but it was worth it, in the hope of a few extras. If there was another farmer's strike, it was also best to have more, in case. That day was quiet, and the people there weren't looking for any kind of distraction or charity, and were only bent double all day in their patches. pulling up cabbages. Still, I stopped and watched them, the people with their hands in the soil, who seemed to have so much authority. They've brought the country to its knees, was what Mrs. P was always saying, but we were also told that this kind of industry didn't exist far outside of London. There was a reason no one left. I spent my time walking over the once grazed grass, now manually cut, and imagined the flocks of sheep trotting over it, bleating. My grandmother said you could never get quite close enough to touch them, but you could try. I imagined pressing my fingers into the soft woolly fuzz, patting their solid backs and seeing their heads turn in curiosity towards me. The sheep were long gone when I arrived, but the vegetables remained. After school, most of us worked there. I'd been spared, my grandmother told me, by sewing. She had been spared too, but only after making her way over here with a wave of immigrant laborers recruited after the blackout. I walked there and imagined I was amongst them, my own hands blackened from soil and bent from picking, trying to stuff an extra mushroom in my pocket instead of being pinched by a pin and bent by a needle. I walked up to the fences and put my hands against the wire. Sometimes they looked at me like I was eyeing up the carrots and waiting for them all to go, to scale the allotment walls. But I had no way to tell them I only wanted to be where the people were and feel part of it. It wasn't anything more than that. I was free to go as I liked, which meant walking right to the top of Parliament Hill and looking out at the grey city, the tallest buildings, the most crumbled of all of them. I imagined going to them, sitting on top of Big Ben and listening to its loud, reverberating gong, a sound lost to us. But if Big Ben was only the name for the bell, not the clock tower, it became meaningless, I suppose, once it stopped ringing. It wasn't worth staying for long, meandering on my own and getting too close to Kenwood House where the squatters were. I walked over to the west side of the heath, past the neat lines of crops and through the woods, out to the village on the other side. I walked down the hill and stopped on the way to check in on the grocers. There were some apples that had turned in the heat, left to rot in their baskets on the side in the hope someone might be desperate enough to buy them. But there were beetroots, one of those valuable things that if you take care of and grow right, you can have all year round. You could save them for a while too, in case there was a strike to eat through. I handed the woman at the counter my coupons and clutched the soily jewels to my chest, imagining the earthy sweetness and bright pink juice I'd stare at in the sink after they'd been cut, knowing the tips of my fingers would be stained for hours. I'd put some on my lips, and my grandmother would laugh at me. I rubbed my face in an old shop window, trying to look presentable again before going back. Sometimes I'd come back from the heath with a few extra vegetables and pretend the grocer had dropped a little extra in for us. This pleased her. I walked in and bundled the beetroots on the side. My grandmother raised her eyebrows without saying anything, a mouth full of pins. She held a long trailing dress in her hand, a silver blue fish of a dress, nothing like I'd ever touched, and she was sitting, hand sewing each glinting button-like bead onto the material with meticulous care, one after the other. She gestured for me to sit next to her and she pulled the thread up in a deft motion, holding it taut and showing it to me, then threading it back down in a loop. I watched her putting the last glinting sequin onto the skirt, long enough for the tallest of women until it fell, complete, around the floor of the workshop, reminding me of a fish I hadn't seen from a sea I hadn't seen. It had been her life for weeks, and I'd known it. I knew how it hurt her to part with the clothing coupons she was saving for fabric before the client paid her. But these commissions were rare, delicate things, and still, there was the old way about them, making the thing first and fitting it, before any questions were asked, any money exchanged. I asked her how she knew the woman would pay, and she gestured to her hair. She smelled like lavender, she said, not hard work. And what if she doesn't pay you? I asked, fingering the slip of paper she kept pinned to the dress's neck with the client's name and telephone number on it. She threw up her hands in dismay. Well then, she said, c'est la fin des haricots. We laughed about it, but if the woman hadn't shown up and paid us, like we hoped she would, it might as well have been the end of the world, the end of our little world. The note on the dress read, Gloria, and I rolled it around my tongue and imagined her. I slipped a hand down the bodice and touched the sleek lining, my dry fingertips snagging on the fabric. I could see her, the Gloria in my head, smelling of lavender and sweet, all red cheeks and waved hair, touching me on the shoulder and laughing with me. When Gloria arrived to collect the dress at the shop, she was better than all of that. She made an impression on me like a knife in butter. I stood behind my grandmother, afraid to look at her, tall and more beautiful than I could have imagined, and smelling like bergamot. I imagined her rows of perfume and the choices she made each day, deciding on her scent. I pressed my hair behind my ears and looked at my shoes, the laces dragging along the floor. I touched my hair again. My grandmother had no such shame with her, thrusting the dress at her, taking the money gladly, not even looking up from her ledger when Gloria exclaimed about the exquisite job she'd done. "I can't believe it! It's magic! What a talent, madame!" She held the dress up by its shoulders so that the pink tissue paper slid to the floor. I wanted to pick it up and fold it, save it for another order. She stepped forward and trod on it. "Oh, what Paris must have been like," she said. I looked at my grandmother, afraid, surprised she told Gloria where we were from. "I mean, before," Gloria said, fiddling with the hem. My grandmother shrugged. "It was marvelous, bien sûr," she said instead of the real thing. Gloria nodded, accepting the claim. I wanted to open my mouth and gesture to the city outside and say, "I go to the hill almost every day and look at the abandoned, crumbling buildings and imagine my Paris like that." But it must be worse. I try and visualize it, but I can't. But logically, I know it must be worse than that, all parched and wiped out, with not even the windows left as they are left here, no glass left even in the window frames. I wanted to ask her if she'd ever marveled at the glass left unshattered in her windows. But instead, I said quietly, leaning forward towards her, "You look beautiful in it, I'm sure." She laughed and folded the dress back up, laying it on the counter. "And what a treat you are. I must thank you both. You have to come to a little dinner I'm having. How do you say it? Soirée?" But she said it like souris, which could have been a mouse or a smile, but most definitely was not a party. My grandmother humored her. "I don't go to parties, I'm afraid, but my Mathilde will be happy to." "Oh, wonderful," Gloria said, eyes wide and bright and looking me up and down, no doubt realizing her mistake. She took my grandmother's pen from her hand without asking and wrote her address down. I wondered whether I should ask her what to wear or tell her I couldn't come because I had nothing suitable. But she was gone in a blink, tissue paper left strewn and torn on the floor. Gloria introduced me at the party as the French dressmaker's daughter. I didn't want to correct her, despite her being my grandmother and not my mother. She did mother me, and despite my being perfectly English, I was, at one point, at least on paper, French. In that giant fairy tale house on the corner of Arkwright Road, with black window frames, crawling ivy, and a red brick wall, I sat at the dining room table with an intricate lace-edged tablecloth placed over it. I studied the place settings, I watched the white plates, I waited with my hands folded. I said very little, but it went unnoticed. All the care and attention that had been put into the arrangement of the crockery was soon dismantled, with people touching the prongs of their forks and swirling their glasses around the tablecloth, watching the indentations they made in the linen like ripples forming on the surface of a pool. It was the first time I ever tasted fish, the real thing. And I asked where they caught it from, and they laughed at me. I held onto my linen napkin and fingered the hem. I pressed each individual stitch between my fingers and touched the starchy whiteness of it. I thought, that's one thing I know. I know how to stitch this. I know how to make something. And maybe they don't. I thought that if I held the napkin, it would save me from this dinner party and transport me to somewhere that made more sense, somewhere that had a cozy domesticity about it, or a place where people ate fish whenever they wanted. I looked into my lap the whole meal, but when I held my napkin like that, that's when the man next to me turned to me and said, "You have better taste in food, no doubt. Tin tuna is not the height of sophistication." He said it like we were sharing a joke, and I looked at my plate and wondered if it was tuna we were eating or if he was referring to something else. I smiled and agreed, and his assuredness gave me a feeling I hadn't had before. and it owned me. That night, after tasting the fish, I felt an opening in time, one I hadn't known could exist. Gloria worried about me, clearing my plate, at one point stroking my hair from my shoulder, but Gloria's care did not betray an ounce of her knowing what she had done for me. I was not myself. I had an urge to recount my whole life to that man, a stranger. He tapped my cutlery to indicate which utensil to pick up. He gestured here and there to show me where to stand and what to do. And when a woman sat down, a stranger then, at the piano, I wanted to cry just from seeing the black and white keys and her feet moving on pedals I didn't even know pianos had. I marveled at the lamps jutting from the wall and wondered how they stayed lit all throughout the evening. Their flickering a constant washing over us, taking away the need for waxy candles on the table that would ruin the cloth. He stood closer to me, to reassure me. That's why I told him, later, for no reason at all, about the recipe books that were in a box in the attic. We found them when we tidied out my mother's house in Paris and sold her things. Condensed her life into two boxes. The pages were worn and stuck together, smatterings of stains littering the pages, covering pictures of things I'd never eaten. But I didn't tell him that I felt resentful of her, so I had thrown them away. Before I left, my grandmother told me Gloria was married to someone important, a politician whose name I should have known, but didn't. It worried me, and naive as I was, I spent the evening looking around, waiting for Mrs. P herself to enter the room. I worried what they'd think of me, into my 20s and childless, with the policy enforced so strictly these days. But I was struck by how adult that dinner was, in all of its tone and form. It was different from the parties I went to with my own friends, the ones still around. I didn't realize it until someone presented a bottle of wine halfway through the dinner, a symbol of not worrying about your condition, and no one seemed to falter, pause, or worry about drinking alcohol, or for that matter, finding it any way surprising to be presented with alcohol at all, especially as it wasn't some homemade concoction, but a wine with a label and a cork yet to be popped. I didn't touch it, of course, and felt my face radiate as it was offered to me, as though it were a test. The answer was obvious, but the young woman at the piano had a glass that was even refilled, and I assumed she wasn't older than 25. After that, I concluded this was what wealthy people did as an escape, and their children were all safely at home. But no one hinted at my flat belly or marital status, and no one even mentioned Mrs. P's policy, except as a passing comment as a measure of her strength. I hid my own ambivalence about Mrs. P that evening, and realized as I did so that my opinion of our leader was only inherited bias from my grandmother. When people spoke of Auntie's strong will and the way she turned the country around after the blackout, I felt that I'd criticized her with my grandmother unfairly. They even joked about the slogan that had brought her into power, "England isn't eating," in between gorged mouthfuls. Someone held up a slimy fork full of food and declared, "Without her putting food into all our mouths, we'd be dust. Auntie knows best." They also talked about things in front of them, the glasses and where they came from, each item's weighted history, the pieces of the continent they'd been to, the scarf they'd got from Spain years ago, the cutlery from Prague, all of this without struggle. So much so that as the evening progressed, I felt it wouldn't have mattered a great deal if I had touched the wine after all, if it would even have been noted or commented on. Certainly not by him, sloshing his glass about and explaining to me, as though my polite refusal warranted a lesson in what I was missing, about the taste, the earth the grapes came from, not English earth, presumably, and its legs, which he showed to me with great adoration as he swilled the red liquid around and watched it fall down the glass. Gloria stroked my hair and patted my shoulder at intervals, in that intimate way she had. Every so often she'd exclaim, "The dressmaker's daughter, all hours for the night. We collect people here." He smiled, gesturing to the woman at the piano. "It's true," he said. "We do." But Gloria stroked everyone's arm, didn't she? I watched her and her way with people. I listened to her conversations and observed her clinking her glass with a friend who had long hair, waved in the same way Gloria's was. They stood in confidence as Gloria nudged her shoulder. "Oh, Wendy, you strumpet," laughing heartily, her mouth at a friend's ear. Her friend's hand pressed to her waist to quell her laughter. "Stop it, Gloria." I smiled after them, not realizing I was doing so, and Gloria noticed me from a few steps away. She gestured for me to come over and then wrapped a convivial arm around me, pointing to her friend, "Wendy, darling, this is the dressmaker's daughter." She patted her gown appreciatively, "Mathilde, this is Wendy, darling." "Is that really your name?" I said, as she outstretched her hand and suppressed a laugh, eyeing Gloria. "Second star to the right," Gloria laughed. Wendy, darling, shook my hand vigorously. "Gwendolyn," she said, and made a face as if to say, "Isn't it awful? It happened quite by accident." At the end of the night, the same man touched my arm, and I watched his fingers press my skin and lift as he removed them. He looked at me, puzzled, and I laughed at nothing in particular. I laughed because he was a severe sort of man, with white strands through his dark hair. I laughed because he was oddly formal in every gesture and while he spoke to me. I laughed because of the way he stood and listened to the woman at the piano, and watched as I watched her feet moving about the piano's feet. I laughed because he had touched me with a sense of urgency and then stopped, as though remembering himself. He stood at the doorway of Gloria's large house on the corner. "Is that your bike, Mathilda?" he asked me, and I nodded, pleased with the inclusive anglicization of my name, but embarrassed by the bike's handlebars and the rusty spokes and the way it would squeak if he stood there and watched me go. He pulled at his shirt cuffs, standing at the doorstep, and opened his mouth to speak. He was interrupted by Gloria appearing behind him, leaning from his side to speak to me, her perfectly waved red hair falling intimately at his shoulder. "Don't ruin your dress on that thing," she called to me. "Pull your skirt up, mind your shoes." She laughed, head held back, satisfied with her joke. And I laughed too, trying to think of something to say to impress her. But she disappeared as soon as she arrived, back into her winding hollow corridor that led to the dining room. I turned to walk towards my bike, without saying anything. I kept my arms close to my sides, worried that sweat had stained the fabric of my pale blue dress, which I hoped to unpick later and return to the shop. The humidity of the night air clung to my legs. I waded through it. I put my small fabric bag in the basket at the front and pulled the bag towards me. It clicked and whirled as I moved it forward. He was still waiting there, by the front door, pulling at his shirt sleeves. "Get home quickly now," he said. "The watch will be after you." I nodded to him. I smiled. "I'll call on you soon. You're not too far, are you, in Hampstead?" "No," I said. "Just to the west." He waved at me, his broad hand towering over his head. "George," he said. "Don't forget, it's George." I walked my bike down the drive, out past the stone wall. I walked it far down the length of Arkwright Road, down the sloping hill that rattled the pedals, before stopping and leaning my bike against a wall. It had been papered over with a fresh poster of a black and white graphic of Mrs. P's face. I stopped and looked at her eyes, lit from candlelight, emanating over the road. "Auntie knows best," it read. I pulled up my dress, just as Gloria had said, and rode home in the dark. 3. That week my grandmother brought home a punnet of gooseberries. She rushed to our garden flat and bounced them at me, and they rolled about each other. I picked one up by its tail and put it in my mouth, my face pruned pleasurably at the tartness. She treated them with great care. She used them every way she could, their flesh for flavoring, their skin for fragrant water. She boiled them and watched them burst and split, and she used their stinging sweetness carefully. One punnet lasted us days, and those gooseberries were a mask for all her melancholia. As long as she had something that had been granted to her, she could hide behind its happiness. She collected our ration coupons religiously, and was always the first in the village to queue outside the issuing office for them. She was careful never to spend them all and save plenty just in case. Every morning she laid them out on the scrubbed wooden table and counted them. She recorded what we had in her small red notebook, laid its ribbon down as a marker, and then snapped it shut. She looked at the coupons like they were a crossword, and she would stare at them in great stillness until she decided what we could eat that would cost us the least amount and last us the longest. On good days, she might decide we could have a chicken wing, parceled up in greasy brown paper and thin on the bone, and only if the queue wasn't too long, once word got around. On bad days, it was only vegetables, and the grey bread they sold you stale to stop you eating it too quickly. The rest of the day, she would hurry to her shop, and on the days that I was working, I would follow her. But even when she wasn't at the shop, I would come home and find her by the fireplace, leaning over a piece of stitching, pins in her mouth, and pausing to count the logs we had left, or blowing on the fire when it threatened to go out. If I think of her now, I remember her perfectly like that. Quiet and contemplative, and always thinking of three things at once. Three things to make sure she hadn't dropped one small thing that would affect us, that would mean we would do without. Even in the summer, with the windows blown open and the smell of plant life throughout the village and the abundance of crops, she would still sit and stitch and count and make sure. I was sure it was because she had a memory of how things fall apart, in the way that I didn't. That was a good day, shortly after Gloria's dinner party, when she came home with gooseberries. They had a small crop of them coming to the grocer's, and no one knew where they came from, but no one asked. She said she hadn't seen them for months, years maybe, and she held one above her head between her fingers as though it was the sun, and she was the small planet below. They didn't even cost us that much, she said, laying out our coupons again and counting them. We'll be all right. She manically prepared them, splitting them up, deconstructing them, until they looked nothing like food. She sang the whole time, sleeves rolled up and her hair pulled from her face, apron tied at her waist, for no reason in particular, other than as a way to feel normal, I imagine, to feel how she used to feel when she had baking ingredients that would sputter about her. I watched her as I flicked through the orders we had at the shop and went through her notebooks and looked at the inventory. Cash was always tight, but she ran a meticulous and tidy shop in every sense. She knew how to make things work, and I admired her greatly for it. And she was reliable. People always chose to come to her, for a knitted jumper in winter or a new house dress, because she knew how to make their clothing coupons go as far as they could. She finished preparing the gooseberries and wiped her hands clean on her apron. She laid down her knife and put a hand up to her hair. I was thinking the other day of crumpets, she said, without turning around. I frowned. I couldn't remember them. It was like a test I was constantly failing. Crumpets, I said, with little intonation. I didn't want her to know I didn't know what she meant. They were lovely toasted, she turned to look at me. Now the work with the gooseberries was over, her normal contemplative look returned. She moved towards me conspiratorially, bending down to my chair, as though she'd just told me a secret, and then she whispered, we had them with butter and jam when we first got here. Do you remember? Both? I couldn't imagine it. She pulled a chair beside me and sat down. She picked up the notebooks I was going through. She looked toward the open windows. I saw sweat forming on her upper lip and around her temples. We had whitewashed the walls and cleared the heavy furniture, taken up the carpets. But in summer, it was never enough. We were never prepared for it. Margot missed them, of course, such a trivial English thing. But I imagine asking her about them. Margot, these strange little English muffin things, they taste good. But I'm sure she would have laughed at me and asked why I was suddenly besotted with British pastries. She did this often. She remembered my mother. She always called her Margot, never your mother. An impersonal touch. But it made sense to her, and was a way to remember her, just as she had been. She seemed to be deep underwater when she talked like that. She never talked about the day we left, or what we left behind. She never probed about my aversion to speaking the language, but she went on with it all the same. You met someone nice at Gloria's, didn't you? I don't know, grandmother. I put my hand on hers and looked with her out the window. There's nothing wrong with it. Your friends have all done it. Better that way, isn't it? I still have a few years, I said, and removed my hand. I felt angry all of a sudden, of the ease with which she talked about my mother and my own frivolity. Not long when you think about it, and someone like you, you'd be set for life. I imagined one of her old jellied pies, the fat that was molded and cooled, and set like that as a barrier so that no meat would leak out from the pastry, constrained and suffocated and stuck. I tried to taste the fat, that wobbly, shiny, glutinous texture, but I couldn't imagine it. Margot and I had the little money once. We had things you wouldn't dream of. I would want that for you, one day. I would want that. But she said it as though she believed its opposite. We both looked out the window as though we were watching a play, and I don't know what we were waiting to appear at its ledge, with only one other house on the street occupied. But we did that frequently, worried about our empty street. My grandmother stood up and went towards the pane, Leaning above the sink, she pressed her nails into the white-chipped sill, its blackened edges rotting in the frame. I wanted to prise her fingers from it and move them away. "Is everything all right?" I said. "Of course," she said, but she didn't move her fingers from the sill. I just wondered if the neighbors would be out today. There were groups of people from the village scattered about. They marched past our house every so often, on watch. They pushed handwritten notes through the letterbox about supporting Mrs. P and standing firm against the farmers' strikes and how they were holding the country to ransom. About how Mrs. P had let the country flourish and the nation be fed. How beyond our borders there was nothing. Not even within the countries that were once part of our collective kingdom. They wrote about the dangers of the abandoned buildings that were filled with squatters, most recently Kenwood House. But they only wrote about them stealing our water and scant electricity, hacking the grid. They never mentioned a potential for violence. That threat they internalized. Of course, part of the watch was to make sure everyone in the village was doing things just as they should. She started scrubbing the counter. She wiped it furiously, over and over, and I spoke her name, but she didn't stop. She wiped her finger against the surface, tasted it. I came and stood beside her. "Touch it," she said. "Can you taste the gooseberries? Can you smell them?" Of course I could, because it was so foreign. I thought that smell had got into everything. I smelt it for days afterwards, in my bed. I smell it now, still, everywhere, and in everything. I shook my head. I hugged her and soaked up her smell, of parsley she'd planted in the garden. She hoped we'd have enough water that summer that it would survive. As I pulled away, she sniffed again, smelling me for tartness. "It makes me anxious sometimes," she said. "The people that walk past the house, I always feel like they're looking for something." She looked at the scraps of fruit, now in the bin. I knew she was thinking, as she always did, of that day. Years after we'd come to London and she'd had the shop. They came straight through our front door, with no warning, into the kitchen. They did it to everyone on our street. They went through everything, every scrap of food we couldn't account for with our coupons was noted. Everything was taken away, our cards too. We stood in line for days to be reissued them, along with everyone else. We were warned about the black market. We were warned about the rules. We could have starved. One more week, and we would have. She bought those gooseberries from the grocer's shop, little balls of joy. But it was something different, and so it made everyone afraid, having to account for something like that. When the farmers were protesting not being paid fairly for produce, when it was collected by the government to be redistributed, the risk of looking like you'd bought something on the black market was not insignificant. "It's just different now," she said. "You just can't trust anyone like you used to." She turned on the tap to wash her hands and the pipes croaked and gurgled and a dribble of water escaped its mouth, then stopped. "That's it for today then," she said, and hit her hand against the tap's neck until another dribble escaped. "Merde." "It's okay. We saved enough until tomorrow," I tried to take the worry out of her. I was always doing that. But I was only a child during the blackout. I couldn't remember it the way she could. She always thought when the water stopped, when the lights turned out, none of it would ever come back on. I didn't believe in that possibility. Not then. "What are you making?" I said. "Putain," she said, as though I were an irritant, and had reminded her. "It will have to do without sugar." She had a small jar of cream she'd managed to buy that day, and she sniffed at it. She moved it towards me so I could check it hadn't curdled too. "Gooseberry fool," she said. Four. George arrived at my door uninvited. He was dressed smartly in a synthetic jumper that looked knitted by a machine. New and far too warm for this weather. His shoes were in such good order they looked like they would squeak and press upon his toes. He came with a newspaper under his arm, and sure enough, Mrs. P's face loomed out of it. I didn't ask how he got my address or had known my grandmother would be at her shop, but I was sure he'd accounted for it. I led him into the kitchen and started to clear things from the table. I looked around, desperately, to try and see the house how he would see it, for the first time. It was pokey and worn, but it was clean, at least, and my grandmother kept things in the best condition she could. "Did you see in the paper there's been another outbreak of dengue?" he said. "Where?" The north was closed off and cooler, but I knew nothing of the continent. We'd stopped buying newspapers 3 years before. "Spain. What's left of it. They think there'll be another migration to the north. There's nowhere else to go. Since the blackout, Scandinavia's borders were firmly secured, firmer even than ours. He looked out the back window, past the chipped gouges of paint on the sill, through the murky glass, out to the parched garden. He looked back at me, at my jeans, my hands in my pockets. I moved my hands up and rubbed them together. I didn't know what he was thinking of, but he made a comment about my pathetic vegetable patch and how it would dry out to death in this weather. I ignored it, because I had to believe I'd be able to grow something. "It's quiet round here," he said. "Same as anywhere." I thought of the people in Spain, the sticky air, the arid earth that crunched. I laid awake at night, trying to imagine what might be worse. Dying down there in the heat, the tropical weather torturing you, until the only thing that isn't in drought is the moisture in your own body. Then that leaving you, too. I thought of what got people here. Trees splitting onto your bicycle, the hot world beating at you. Not built for this weather. Getting E. coli from old rations, things that have been left to spoil. Or starving. That happened to people who weren't alone. Who gave all they had to their families. Who didn't account for the strikes. Who had children. They tried to account for that. They tried to incentivize you. But if there wasn't enough food, it didn't count for anything. I thought about it logically, what was worse, and sometimes wrote it down. That's when he placed something on the work surface. I didn't know what it was. It was an egg shape, something textured and wrinkled. I thought it was a pear. "I've brought you something," he said, and I looked at it. "A fruit?" He looked at it. He didn't know. "Or a vegetable?" he said, as though he was asking the thing itself. That's when I knew it really meant something. "It's an avocado. Have you heard of it?" I thought about pretending I had, so that he might think I was older than I was. That he might think something good about me. "No," I said. "Have you?" He laughed, the way he did when he thought I'd just missed the mark. "I brought it to you, didn't I? You can mash it up and cut it open and..." I didn't think he knew what it was. We both looked at it. I marveled that he could get hold of things. "You shouldn't have brought a thing like that," I said. "It's not safe, with the watch." He laughed. "They won't come here. I'll make sure of it." He shrugged his shoulders. "Friends in high places," I said, as a joke. But I was frightened. "When you're a minister, you know what's going on. You have some control." "You work with Mrs. P?" I said. I didn't ask minister for what. He smiled. "Don't we all?" I looked at the thread of his jumper and wanted to touch its softness, but I thought it would be unbearably warm in this summer humidity. The thought of it clinging to his arms like that disturbed me, but its neatness gave me the impression he might know the answer to something. He ran his hands through his hair, and I watched the gray strands and I watched the dark ones. I watched his fingertips. He moved closer to me and placed his hand next to mine on the counter. That's the first time we touched, or almost touched. But it mattered all the same. Getting close was just as monumental as the thing itself. "You're a small bird," he said, or at least that's what I thought he said, but he murmured it so close to me, and I didn't want to ask him to repeat it. "That sounds right, though. He would have said that." "I'm going to help you," he said, and I didn't know what that meant either. All I knew is that there was a man in my kitchen who was older than me and knew something about the world I didn't. With everything the way it was, it mattered. "My neighbor died last week," he said, his hand next to mine. "Oh, I'm sorry." She used to keep old packets of sugar in drawers around her house. She used to collect them from the old cafes. His hand moved closer, but didn't touch mine. She talked about streetlights and tiny computers. She said her head was filled with noise. He laughed, but I think even then I could tell the laugh wasn't sincere. He would have given a lot to have a computer. It was peaceful anyway. She lived a good long while. I nodded, wanting to ask what a good long while was, wanting to compare it to my mother's good long while. I tried to imagine his neighbor's face, but couldn't. I thought about where the sugar was now. He reached into his coat pocket and took out some paper. At first I thought it might be a newspaper clipping or a picture, and I thought I'd like to see what she looked like. But then he unfolded it and placed it alongside the avocado on the counter. He left it there, arching up at its long indented folds. I pressed it down with my hand. "You didn't," I said. "I want you to have it. But it's fraud." "It's not fraud when you have nothing. Debatable." That's when his hand did grasp mine, that first time. I wondered why he'd want to touch my hand, and was it in the same way I wanted to touch his? "There's no point in ethics now. Don't even think of it. Take it." He raised his voice and stepped towards me. He squeezed my hand a little too tight. "You must take it." He released his hand to place it on my shoulder. "I can't take it," I said. "I feel too bad about it." But I didn't, because if I died, I'd want someone to have my ration card. I'd want everyone to have what they wanted. My house, my muddy garden, my plant pots, my kitchen tiles, my eyes, my skin. I'd want them to take it all and use it and put it back into the earth where it belongs. I'd want my body to be fertilizer, to grow trees and carrots. I'd do anything. I didn't feel bad, but I was afraid. "You know the old saying, food first, then morals," he said. He looked at me. "I'll keep it. If you ever need it, I'll have it." He nodded towards the garden. "Thank you," I said. But I was worried that this gesture was a final thing and an indication he wouldn't return. "Of course," he said. "I worry about you and your vegetable patch. They are but for the grace of God." I knew he meant he had more than me, but he didn't owe me anything. I couldn't think of anything to say. Wanted to ask if he'd be back, fearing that if I did, it would prompt him to never return. Better not to know. So instead, I found myself murmuring under my breath the rest of the phrase. He looked at me quizzically as I said, "Go, I bit into the avocado and almost immediately spat the whole thing back out. The skin was leathery, but the inside moist and slippery. It was sinister. The remnants in the sink stared back at me. The green was sickly, a pale, luminous green, not like a courgette. The flesh was thick and doughy, but not as doughy as a banana. Smoother, sleeker, disconcerting. The mound of the seed rose up at me from the half-cut portion on the chopping board, a large conker of a thing. I tried to prise it out, smushing the flesh surrounding it as I did so, laying perfectly against its round casing. It was just as I remembered kiwis, but not acidic, not transparent, no bite. This was no fruit.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.